Hey fellow Vault Dwellers, it's Angry Turtle, and patch notes for patch 22 just arrived, and we'll take a look what's in it. Hopefully everything that's supposed to be in here. We are releasing update 22 today, which includes new features like One Wasteland, Daily Ops, Legendary Perks, and the start of our second Fallout 76 season. This update also brings a number of additional improvements and bug fixes to the game, so be sure to read on to catch the patch notes. Update 22 highlights. One Wasteland. Creature levels now adjust dynamically to more closely match character levels, so you can adventure anywhere in Appalachia, whether alone or with your friends. Fallout 76 Season 2. Join Armor Ace and the Power Patrol in their battle against the Red Vipers by ranking up on all new scoreboard and claiming tons of rewards along the way. Daily Ops. Gear up, grab your pals, and get ready to take on challenging, repeatable, and randomized encounters called Daily Ops. Legendary Perks. Become legendary with new high-level perk cards that will offer more power and build diversity to your characters. Then we have update version, and it's big. This update is huge. On PC, on Bethesda.net, that's the smallest, that 23 gigabytes. The biggest one, Xbox One, 42 gigabytes. Hopefully, guys, you have good internet connection for this one. One Wasteland. With today's update, we are excited to introduce One Wasteland to Fallout 76, which allows creatures to dynamically adjust their levels up or down on the fly to more closely match each player they encounter. If multiple players all come across the same enemy at the same time, its level will simultaneously rise for the higher level players and drop for the lower level players. And that actually is a good addition. In addition to their levels, each creature's damage, health and resistances, as well as the loot they drop and the experience they award, will also better match each player. This means that all players who are adventuring together can have an impact on any given combat encounter, even if there is a large level gap between them. While creatures will still have minimum and maximum levels, such as a max of level 50 in the forest, they are now much more flexible overall. One Wasteland opens up more opportunities to adventure anywhere in Appalachia, whether alone or with your friends. It's also smooth out some of the early game bumps for new players, allows higher level players to get max level loot in previously lower level regions, and should offer more consistent combat encounters for everyone. This loot part is very interesting for me. I'm going to explore forest. Catch even more details by reading our recent One Wasteland preview article on Fallout.com. Or you can check my One Wasteland preview video on my channel. Season board and rewards. Join Armor Ace and the Power Patrol in their march against the oppressive Subjugator and his army of Red Vipers minions during Fallout 76 Season 2, which begins today. Season 2 brings the all-new Armor Ace scoreboard to the game, featuring 100 ranks for you to achieve during the next 10 weeks. We've added a host of rewards that you will unlock as you rank up, including new power armor paints, armor and weapon skins, themed cosmetics, camp items, in-game currencies, perk card packs, and more. We've made several adjustments this season that you may want to keep in mind as you dive in. Rank ups will be purchasable immediately, so those who would like to rank up using atoms can join the fight to crush the Red Vipers starting today. It's not a recommended option. We've implemented some new daily and weekly challenges, such as Daily Ops Team Challenges, to offer you even more day-to-day variety as you rank up. We're also adding more weeklies to the challenge lineup, so you have more flexibility to progress on your schedule. Finally, we've made several of last season's rewards, like lunchboxes, the ammo converter, available at gold bullion vendors, so players who miss them have another opportunity to unlock them. Head to the seasons page on Fallout.com and read our recent Season 2 preview article to get more information about Season 2, as well as a look at the rewards that will be up for grabs. Daily Ops. Put your skills to the test by taking on instanced, randomized, and repeatable encounters called Daily Ops. Daily Ops are fairly challenging, and so we recommend them for characters who are level 50+. It's worth to mention here that because they use one wasteland scaling mechanism, if you have a couple of friends and you are level 20, you can surely finish it as well. Our first game mode for Daily Ops is called Uplink, which will require you to secure a series of uplinks to track down and destroy enemies that are threats to Appalachia. In Daily Ops, you will square off against enemies from a single faction who are affected by a unique mutation which will make them deadlier and more challenging to take down. Complete your objectives, eliminate the enemy threat, and you will be rewarded for your effort to make Appalachia a safe place for everyone. To join Daily Op, open the map screen and find the new world activity tracker we've added in the lower left corner. Select a Daily Op from the list to learn more about it, including which location, enemies, and mutation you will face. Enter Daily Ops directly from the tracker by clicking the join button. You can take on Daily Ops alone or in a team of up to 4 other players. Each day, Daily Ops will feature a fresh combination of location, enemy faction, and enemy mutation to keep you on your toes. Locations: the Barrows, the Burning Mine, Valley Galleria, or Vault 94. Enemy factions: Super Mutants, Blood Eagles, or Robots. Enemy mutations: Piercing Gaze. This mutation is always applied to enemies, the Uplink Daily Ops mode, and gives them greatly enhanced perception of players. It actually gives them 100% detection of everything, means sneak doesn't work. Volatile. Enemies will explode on death. Active camouflage. Enemies will be clocked when not attacking. Resilient. Enemies can only be killed by a melee attack, but you can still do damage to them with your weapons and you can finish them off by bashing. Check my guide for Daily Ops if you want to know more. Freezing Touch. Enemy attacks will freeze players. Since you will be facing constant combat and deadly threats during your operations, we've reduced the condition damage taken by your weapons and armor by 50% while in Daily Op. What actually amazing quality of life change for Daily Ops. Like the event A Colossal Problem, creatures in Daily Ops will drop ammo based on the weapons you are using when you take them down. This will help keep your ammo reserves top off through lots of combat. And that's another amazing feature. You can repeat Daily Ops as often as you would like each day, and you will receive a base set of rewards every time you complete one. However, there are 3 additional reward tiers that you can reach once per day by completing a Daily Op within certain time limits. Initiate, 16 minutes or less. Paladin, 12 minutes or less. Elder, 8 minutes or less. You aim for Elder. The higher the tier you achieve, the higher your chances to get better rewards, including more experience, larger amount of in-game currencies, legendary items, and even brand new items like the Warglaive, which is customizable two-handed melee weapon. And this one I want. After finishing a Daily Op, you will be able to view an operation report, which shows you how fast you managed to complete it, which reward tiers you reached, and a list of the rewards you earned, except for experience and currencies. And we have legendary perks. If you want to know every single one of them, I already have a series of four videos explaining them. But let's read in here. Legendary perks are new high-level perk cards for players who have reached level 50+, which will help you add even more power and build diversity to your characters. We've added a new legendary perks button to the top of the normal perk card menu, which you can use to access and modify your legendary perk slots and cards. You will unlock your first legendary perk slot at level 50 and up to 6 slots in total at certain level milestones. After that, 75, 100, 150, 200 and 300. Those are milestones. If you already have high level characters, they will immediately have access to one legendary perk slot for each of the above milestones they've reached. For example, a level 250 character will have access to 5 legendary perk slots and will gain a 6th slot at level 300. One legendary perk card can be equipped to each slot, and you can unequip them at any time in exchange for one perk coin. More on perk coins below. Legendary perk slots are account-wide and will be available to all of your characters as soon as you unlock them. Even your characters below level 50 will be able to equip legendary perks in these slots, which gives them access to more power at an earlier stage of the game than your higher level characters had at that level. With legendary perks, we're introducing perk coins, which you can use to increase the power of your legendary perk cards by upgrading them. Earn perk coins by scrapping your unused normal perk cards. Each perk card you scrap will grant you 2 perk coins per rank. In other words, per star of your card you have 2 perk coins. For example, when you scrap a rank 1 perk card you will receive 2 perk coins, and scrapping a rank 3 perk card will award 6 perk coins. Each legendary perk card can be upgraded up to 3 times at a price of 50, 100 and 150 perk coins to reach ranks 2, 3 and 4 respectively. While legendary perk slots you've unlocked are account-wide, your legendary perk selections and upgrades are separate for each of your characters. To help give your perk coins collection a boost, we've added a Become Legendary challenge to the character challenge menu, which awards 50 perk coins to characters who reach level 50. Please note, if your character are already level 50+, this challenge will already be completed for them the next time you log in, and the 50 perk coins reward will be added to your perk coin total automatically. Design updates. Fast travel. It's now free to fast travel to Foundation and Crater. They listened to us and they gave us this one. It's small but big at the same time. Combat. Bonus damage. We've changed the way that damage bonuses are calculated so that they now apply additively instead of multiplicatively. That's the damage nerf everyone was talking about for last couple weeks. Please note, while stacking damage bonuses will now have a smaller overall effect on your damage output than before, these challenges will make the resulting damage much more predictable and allow for future improvements. This is very important for the health of the game going forward. It will also create better opportunities for us to make smarter and more effective balance changes. We are still evaluating feedback we gathered on these changes from the PTS, but we also welcome your thoughts on how different weapons and builds feel after today's update, so that we can make additional adjustments in the future. Items. Alien Blaster damage increased by 30%. It still deals almost no damage. But it's a fun fact. Legendary weapons. The Assassin's legendary attribute now applies its bonus damage to humans and PC. What's good, but it's still a very rubbish legendary effect. Secret Service armor. Plans for light and ultralight limb mods for Secret Service armor have been added, and they are now purchasable from Rex in Vault 79. Finally, ultralight, that will save me so much stash space, as my collection of Secret Service armor is getting bigger and bigger. I couldn't wait for this one. Finally, we have it. Shish Kebab now deals fire damage instead of energy damage. No practical difference. Modern Renegade increased Modern Renegade's chance to cripple limbs from 2-3-4% to 4-8-12%, and that's a buff for pistols. Tank Killer. Pistols now benefit from the Tank Killer perk card. That was long requested change. Finally here. User interface. Public teams. We've renamed the building team to casual and removed the casual team bonus. In its place, we've added a Daily Ops team type, which offers bonus experience for completing Daily Ops. 25% base, 100% fully banded team. We did this in part because it is not possible to build in public teammates camps, and partially because most players were using the building team the way we had intended casual to be used anyway. Removing the casual team option It made room for us to add the new daily ops team type, which we feel players will find more useful following today's update. World. World 94 is now accessible during world exploration in adventure mode and private worlds. We can go and explore it again, and without time limits this time. Vault 51. We've added a new no-camp zone around Vault 51 exterior in preparation for future content. I cannot wait to finally get a second vault open. And now we have bug fixes, and I will only read one that are significant. I will skip all the bug fixes related to like small outfit fixes and stuff like that. Lootbags fix an issue with the Vault-Tec duffel bag model that made it difficult to interact with. That's the zipper one I was talking about. Before you were only able to access inside by aiming for the zipper. That was hilarious. Ammo converter some fix for selling 40mm grenade rounds. I didn't even realize it was broken. Oh, finally! Fix an issue that could prevent fast travel to another player's camp if the camp owner had the future tech camp skin equipped. It's not bugged anymore, they fix it. Oh, Communist Bunker. Object placed on the floor of the Communist Bunker no longer appear to float. Awesome. Oh, that's a big one. Exploit. Items can no longer be stuck on objects that are in disrepair. Looks like Sexy Hand Games will need to figure out different way to do so. Exploit. Fix an exploit allowing players to build workshop ammunition factories in their camps. Please note, as a result of this fix, camps and blueprints that contain a workshop ammo factory are now invalid and can no longer be placed. Players will also receive a notification that their camp blueprint cannot be placed if it contains a workshop ammo factory. Finally fixed. It was hilarious exploit. Floors. Farmable dirt tiles can no longer be replaced by other floor types. Oh, why? Oh, I mean, I probably know why, but... it's bad. Oh, for daily scrapping fertilizer now works. Good. Ash and goopies. Players now die immediately when turned into ash or goo pile rather than entering the down but not out state. Respawn implemented a fix to reduce cases where players could become unable to respawn after being killed during the event or in an interior. Please note, this fix may not address all situations that can cause this issue to occur, but it should help, and we are continuing to work on a more complete fix. Hopefully it will be mostly complete, as this is one of the most annoying issues. And what's not stated here about ash and goo piles, at least on the public test server, enemies are respawning correctly from them. That's big as well, I don't know if this will be anywhere down the patch notes. And another one everyone was waiting for, Scourge Beast Queen. The Scourge Beast Queen's wings can now be crippled to cause her to land, and her legs can be crippled to slightly reduce her rotation speed. Finally, no counting on random landing, you can force her to land. 8. Fix an issue in which players were unable to die from radiation damage while affected by max health buffs, like those offered by Buff Out, Buff Tats, and Psychobuff. No more radiation immunity. 8. Mud cookies, swamp tofu, and all omelette recipes no longer incorrectly appear in the cooking station meat category. Exploit. Address an exploit in which players could intentionally double the stat bonus offered by unyielding armors. But it was very often happening unintentionally. Does it mean it will still happen? You just cannot do it intentionally? It's very weird wording. Fireworks. Season 1 is over and equipping fireworks no longer cause players to reload much faster than intended. It was fun when lasted. Loot. Enemies that drop contextual ammo can now correctly drop arrows, crossbow bolts, .38 rounds, 40mm grenade rounds, ultrasight plasma cartridges and ultrasight 2mm electromagnetic cartridges instead of random ammo when players kill them with the appropriate weapons. Still no cores. Fix an issue in which power armor with the junkyard paint was not providing the correct amount of radiation resistance. Shotguns. Fix an issue affecting suppressor shotgun mods that could cause the weapon's range value to be negative. No more guarantee hits at any range. Under Armour. Secret Service Under Armour lining mods can now be correctly applied to Camo Secret Service Under Armour. Oh, General. Players can now correctly acquire more than one mutation in a given play session. I was thinking that it was intentional limitation all this time. It looks like it was a bug. Speed Demon. Fix an issue that reduced impact healing while under the effects of the Speed Demon mutation. That's great, because every my character is using Speed Demon. Critters. Now cap at level 5 and can no longer spawn as legendary. A lot of performance and stability fixes. Important one. Performance. Fix an issue with the Tesla rifle that could result in poor frame rates for nearby players. Finally, the poor frame rates meant like zero frames, like slideshow, that was caused by Tesla ash piles. Class Freak. Fix an issue that could cause some mutation to not interact correctly with the Class Freak perk card. Great. Hopefully it's a positive change. We'll test it out. Concentrated Fire. Rank 3 of the Concentrated Fire perk no longer causes the chance to hit in VATS to suddenly jump to 95% when using an automatic weapon. What they mean by that? So far it was increasing hit chance by 20% with each hit with automatic weapon, and intended is 4%, that they change it to 4%. Now you are getting 4% per hit. It's still 20% for single fire weapons like lower action. It's not a change anyone would be happy about. A colossal problem. Fix an issue where equipping certain types of thrown explosive caused Wendigo spawns to drop random ammo on death. It looks like some people are still using explosives. That's a surprise. An ounce of prevention. Further address an issue that could block quest progression when attempting to analyze the ghoul blood sample. Finally, primal cuts. Quest targets will now appear on all prime beasts instead of only on the last few, which will help players track down any wayward beasts. That's awesome. Primal cuts. During the final wave of prime beast, players are now only required to kill the boss to complete the event. That will help a lot. Vital equipment. Fix an issue in which a player could complete vital equipment multiple times per day if they already had one of the quest items in their inventory. Controls. Fix an issue that could prevent the quick heal button from working properly after switching game modes. That's good. Damage numbers. Grenades and mines now correctly display damage numbers when they hit enemies. Item transfer. Fix an issue that could cause items to be transferred from unintended inventory categories when spamming the transfer button. Finally, it was happening for me so often when I was trying to quickly move something from my stash box. Oh, this one is good. World. The following locations can now be accessed at all times, and attempting to enter them no longer sometimes displays a location available at a later date. Error. Arctos Pharma. Eta Psi House, P House, The Barrows, The Nuka Shine, Van Love Taxidermy. Finally, I was getting it so often, especially when I was going to farm barrows and it was required to hop a server to fix this error. Now it shouldn't be happening anymore. For Defiance, the no camp zone at Fort Defiance has been expanded to include the road in front of Allegheny Asylum to resolve an exploit affecting enemy spawns during the Line in the Sand event. No more farming scorch in one spot. Will not be popular opinion, but I'm happy about that. It was breaking my immersion when all those scorch were spawning at the middle mid-air all the time and people were shooting them. Yeah, I'm happy about this. I like the intended way of this event working. I just want the enemies to spawn more frequently. And that's everything we have in the patch notes. Let me know what you think about it. I will be jumping into the game as soon as I can. Unfortunately, not straight after update because I need to go to work, but my heart will be with you guys. And as always, thank you a lot for watching, and see you guys in the next one.